I am super excited about this build today, guys. I've been wanting to make one of these for a really long time, and I've been slowly accumulating parts and doing research, and finally was able to put one together with this vacuum pump and chamber. This is my leather vacuum forming machine. Okay, so all that means is I have created a space with a silicone membrane where I can suck all the air out with the vacuum pump, and that allows me to form leather around objects. Those objects, in my case, being mostly knives. So what I want to do today is show you how I built this and what parts I used. I want to go over the cost quickly at the end of the video, and I also want to take some time to talk about the pump and vacuum chamber that Vevor sent me for this build. Now, if you want to watch the full build video, I did put out another video where I just put together this machine, and you can see every step that I took and all of the different parts that I used. For now, we'll go through it a piece at a time here, and we'll talk about the top. This is made from two cutting boards that I bought at Walmart. It was the cheapest, most available high-density polyethylene plastic that I could find. The silicone membrane was a piece of silicone that I bought off of eBay. I believe it is 1/32nd of an inch. Basically, this membrane is sandwiched between these two pieces of high-density polyethylene. Now, cutting this stuff from Walmart was a huge pain in the butt. It's not quite dense enough to cut clean, but it's not soft enough that you can really use anything but a saw to try and cut through it. So a lot of it just kind of melted. It didn't cut very cleanly, and it was a pain in the butt. The base, however, was a lot easier to cut on the table saw. So if I were to do it again, I would order this Winco brand cutting board off of Amazon, and I would just get three of these. All of the screws that I used for this build are M5 stainless steel machine screws, and they're all screwed into brass heat set inserts that I set into the bottom pieces of plastic. I wanted all of my screw fittings to be very tight and strong, and I didn't trust screwing directly into the plastic. So I did those heat set inserts, and they turned out to be a fantastic way to get really strong construction on this build. Now, the gasket that I used to go around the frame is just some gasket material that I found at my local auto shop store. What is it, Napa AutoZone? I think it's an AutoZone. And it's just weather stripping. It's a closed foam rubber, so the air can't move through it, and that's what I needed so that it could hold a vacuum. The work surface is made from the inside of one of those cutting boards that I got from Walmart, and it has holes drilled in a regular pattern across the work surface to allow the air to be pulled evenly across the whole tabletop. That will give you an even form on whatever you're working with, right? On the bottom here, you're gonna see the vacuum hose going into the center of the base plate here, and that's where the air is gonna get pulled, right? So I actually just tapped the threads right into the plastic on this and screwed the fitting directly into the plastic. I know they make some pass-through adapters that you could use to put on there that have seals, and then you could screw your fitting into the adapter, but I didn't want to spend any more money, and this seems to be working pretty well. The legs are hairpin legs that I ordered off of Amazon. I could have built a box around this, which is what I've seen most people do when they build vacuum presses, but I don't like the clunkiness of it, I guess. I just thought this looked nicer is really the main thing. And I liked the ability to screw the legs into the base plate with more heat set inserts. Whereas if you had a box built around this, you'd probably have to go through the base plate into the wood on the wooden box. And I didn't think that was gonna be as efficient of a design. I felt like the fewer holes I could put through this base plate, the better. The threaded inserts, they don't go all the way through. So you've got a tighter vacuum. Less places to lose air, right? That's the goal, right? Or I should say, less places to gain air, since we're trying to get rid of the air. So these clamps that I put on the sides, I don't know what they're called. I can't remember. Swing clamps, or I had to modify these a little bit because I don't have the base, the wooden base around here. So these have to clamp onto the base plate. And I did that by bending these clamps with some heat and a vise. And that 90 degree angle allows me to attach these with heat set inserts to the bottom of the base plate, kind of like I did with the legs. I also had to modify the top of these clamps by cutting off part of this triangle so that they could attach to the other half of the clamp. Well, normally these two parts would be on the same plane, but because they're on different planes, I had to adapt the clamps to work for my needs, but they work pretty well. So that's enough, I think, about the table. I think you get the gist of how I constructed it, and it turned out really good. I love how it works, and I'll show you that here. But first, I think we should talk about the Vevor vacuum pump and chamber that they sent me. The pump cost $128 on Vevor's website. That's without a discount. And Vevor, of course, provided this to me for free, which I'm very grateful for. And I really am pleased with the quality of the pump and the chamber. I don't know that much about vacuum pumps, but everything on this is great. There's no blemishes. It all works perfectly. It's smooth. The pump is quiet, and it does exactly what I got it to do at a very affordable price. So I don't have anything negative to say about this product from Vevor. None of this except for the Vevor pump was provided, and I don't have affiliate links for any of this except for the Vevor pump and chamber. So I will provide a link for the pump and chamber in the description, which should provide you guys with a discount if you use my link. I don't usually cash in on those affiliate links anyways. It doesn't seem quite worth it, but it is nice for you guys to be able to get a discount. And I think even without the discount, you're not gonna find a better deal. So total, I spent $158 on supplies. So that's just what went into this table. Now, one thing to note on that is some of those supplies I got locally. Prices are gonna be different in different places. Generally, things are more expensive here in Wyoming because of our distance from the majority of everything. But anyways, so maybe that some of that stuff will be cheaper for you guys where you live. So the total cost all in, assuming you purchase this unit from Vevor, is $286 for everything. And just the versatility of having this pot and the ability to take the lid off and use it for epoxy projects, it just makes this such a versatile setup that for the price, you couldn't beat it. And I'm really happy with how it turned out. You're gonna be seeing it in my videos as I make my sheaths. There's gonna be lots of applications here for wet molding leather, and I think it's gonna be really fun and really cool to use. Let's go ahead and form our top piece of leather for this Kershaw Culpepper sheath. All we have to do here is take the top off. We can place the knife anywhere on the working surface because of all of the holes that we drilled in here. It doesn't matter where we place this. Set the top back on. Use our clamps to hold it in place. then we will go ahead and close our line to the vacuum former and leave our line open to the pump. Then we can go ahead and flip the switch, which is on the back side of the pump here, and pull the air out of the chamber. That should give us plenty of vacuum. I'll go ahead and close off to the pump. That way there's no risk of losing any air out of this side here. Then when we're ready, we can go ahead and open up the valve to the vacuum forming side. So it does a pretty good job by itself, but because this leather has been cased, that means it's not completely floppy. And I'm gonna have to do a little bit of molding by hand just to make sure I get all of that leather where I want it to go. You can see just how tight that silicone molds around the knife. It's really nice having this clear silicone and being able to see your workpiece underneath it. Somewhere in here I have a leak, and after about an hour I'll lose vacuum. And that's okay though, because by the time that hour is over, I have a good permanent mold on my sheath, and the leather doesn't dry out very well underneath this membrane anyways, even when the vacuum's gone. It's like being in a plastic bag. So I have to take the lid off and let it dry out at some point anyways. The vacuum can't stay there forever, and it stays plenty long enough for me to get a really good form. You can see this Buck 110 sheath that I molded yesterday using the same methods. And because it's still a little bit damp, when you take it out from the vacuum, you can put your stitching lines on there, no problem at all. And you're ready to go. Just let it dry out the rest of the way. All we have to do if we want to release the vacuum is we can go ahead and unscrew this side, because it's not under vacuum anymore because our valve here is shut off. And when we're ready, we can slowly release the air here with this valve. And we're good to lift our top off, and we have a good mold around our knife. So, don't forget to go watch the full build video where I take the time to show you all the steps that I went through to build this table. And hey, look, I'm no fabricator. You guys probably have ideas about ways I could have improved my design, and you probably saw stuff I didn't do right. So go ahead and leave a comment. Let me know how I can improve. And I appreciate your time and your support. I hope this video is of some help to you guys. I'm looking forward to seeing you on the next one.